to be in the house of the Lord today. I want to wish all of you fathers out there a great day. Hope that you've been blessed. Just being a father is a blessing. And all you church people out there today, we want to wish you a happy anniversary. Anybody know it's anniversary time? And it's Father's Day. Proverbs chapter 4. Hear, ye children, the instruction of a father, and attend to no understanding. For I give you good doctrine. Forsake ye not my law. For I was my father's son, tender and only beloved in the sight of my mother. He taught me also, and said unto me, let thine heart retain my words, my commandments, and live. Get wisdom and understanding, forget it not, neither decline from the words of my mouth. In the book of Exodus, chapter 15, and verse 2, it says, the Lord is my strength and song, and he has become my salvation, for he is my God. And I will prepare him an habitation, my father's God. And I will exalt him. Isn't it great not only to have a God, but to have a God that was the God of your father also? What better blessing can we have than that? Let's worship the Lord today. Magnify him.
Hallelujah. Come on, let's all clap our hands unto the Lord. Maybe you want to lift your voice. Say praise God. Come on, let's really give him the best praise we have for a while today. Hallelujah.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? Till I met.
Come on, let's sing together.
I was breathing, but not alive.
Oh God.
All my failures I tried to hide. It was mine too. Till I met you.
Oh God,
you called my name, and I ran out of that grave.
Aren't you glad about that?
Out of the darkness into your glorious day.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
You called my name, and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness into your glorious day.
Is anybody glad called your name and brought you out of darkness today? Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Now your mercy has saved my soul.
And God, your freedom.
And now your freedom is all I know.
Say the old made new.
The old made new. Jesus, when I met you,
say you called my name,
you called my name, and I ran out of that grave.
Hallelujah.
Out of the darkness into your glorious day.
Yes,
God, you called my name, and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness into your glorious day.
Come on, everybody, clap your hands to God today. Hallelujah. I needed rescue. My sin was heavy.
my chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan, but now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open. When you call my name, and I ran out of that grave.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
Out of the darkness, into your glorious day.
Thank God.
Yes, you call my name, and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness, into your glorious day.
Oh, how about we testify for a second?
I needed rescue, my sin was heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan, but now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open.
That's when you call my name.
And I ran out of that grave.
Thank God.
Glorious day.
Hallelujah. God,
you called my name, and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness into your glorious day.
Come on, one more time. Let's put our hands together. Let's be thankful today. Hallelujah. Come on, lift your voice and clap your hands. Somebody say, thank you, God, you didn't leave me. Hey, you found me. But my chains were broken because of your glory and your word. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Come on, let's celebrate Jesus today.
Hallelujah.
Oh, thank you, God. Thank you, God.
Yes.
Thank you, God. Oh, I come out of that grave. Oh, I thank you, Jesus, that you called my name. Oh, I was an orphan. God, you gave me healing in my body. God, you've done so much for me that I cannot tell it all. Oh, I thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God, praise God. It feels good in the house of the Lord today. Happy anniversary to the promise. Happy 7 years. Let's give the Lord one more hand of praise for 7 great years. Fantastic, fantastic. And I do believe, I feel like the Queen of Sheba when she went to Solomon. I do believe the half has never been told. I believe that. I sincerely believe we'll see more souls baptized in the name of Jesus over the next 7 years than we did the last 7 years. I believe we'll see more healings, more restorations, more families being brought back to the house of God. I believe that over the next 7 years. I cannot wait to see what God does in our midst. Happy Father's Day to all the fathers and grandfathers and great-grandfathers here. We love you and appreciate you. And happy Father's Day to my dad, my hero. I love all the fathers. Can we give the fathers another big hand today and say we love them and appreciate them in this place? I'm excited about today's service. I'm super excited about everything about it and the minister that we have here, and I cannot wait to see what God has in store for us. And if you have a need today, if you come bearing a need, let's make that known by the uplifting of our hand. God knows every need, and He is able. Can we bind together right now in prayer? Lord, we love you today. God, we thank you, Jesus, for your presence. Thank you for meeting us here once again. God, we ask today that you would touch every need that's represented here, Lord. Lord, every healing, God, every sickness, God, that's in our body, every situation or circumstance, God, something, God, that may be binding our mind, God, you are able and you are more powerful than anything we could ever encounter. And God, we put everything in the palm of your hands. We put our lives and our situations, God, in the palm of your hands, trusting you, God, that you are our way maker and you have everything in control. God, we pray that your glory would fall in this place today. Let your anointing have its way in this service. Oh, God, and we will continue to give you all the praise and the honor and the glory. In the mighty, matchless name of Jesus, we pray. Would you give him one more hand of praise?
Yes, Jesus. Yes, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Yes, the Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? Oh, God, the Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? Yes, I will wait. And I will trust in you. Anybody learning to trust on the Lord? I will trust in you. Sing, I will remain. Confident.
Confident.
The word of the Lord is
truth.
I will see the goodness of the Lord. Yes, I will remain. Confident in this,
I will see
the goodness of the Lord. Say, the Lord is my light and salvation. Who shall I fear?
Who shall I be?
Oh yes, if God said it, you can bank on it.
The Lord is my light
and salvation. Who shall I fear?
Who
shall I be afraid? Yeah, I will wait on you, Jesus.
I will wait on you.
And I will trust in you, Lord.
I will trust in you.
Yes, I will trust in you, Jesus.
I will trust.
Praise God. That's the word of God. Yes, sing, I will remain.
Confident,
I know I will
see the goodness,
yes,
of the Lord.
Yes,
I will remain.
Yes, I will.
Confident in this,
I will see the goodness
of the Lord.
Come on, somebody, clap your hands unto God. Get a little faith in your life today. Come on, God's word is right. Where the Lord will stand, wait on him, God, who proved himself. Yes, God.
We set our hope on you. We set our hope on your love. We set our hope on the one who is the everlasting God. You are the everlasting God. You are the everlasting. We set our hope.
Somebody set their hope on the Lord.
I hope on the one who is the everlasting.
God is always the same. Yes, He is.
You are the everlasting
God.
You are the everlasting.
Say it again.
We said, I hope on you. We said, I hope on the Lord.
We said, I hope on
the
one.
Everlasting God.
God, I trust
you,
Lord.
You are the everlasting
God.
You are the everlasting.
And I will remain confident in this. I will see the goodness of the Lord.
Come on, somebody help me sing that part. Sing.
I will remain
confident.
Come on, sing that in your spirit. I will remain
confident in this.
I will see.
Come on, one more time. Sing that in your spirit today.
Say, I will remain confident in this. I will see the goodness of the Lord.
Father, we love you tonight. God, we are grateful. We give you praise and we give you honor and we give you glory. It all belongs to you, Lord. It all belongs to you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. The Lord richly bless you. You may be seated tonight in his presence. What a beautiful crowd that we have here this afternoon to worship and to praise the Lord. And you're going to hear this a lot tonight, but happy 7th anniversary to the promise. Amen. Happy anniversary. You know, it does not, in any shape, fashion, or form, feel like 7 years since we walked into this building and looked at the possibilities and started dreaming and hoping and praying. And just to look around and see everything that God has accomplished here is nothing short of remarkable and amazing. And it's been each and every one of you being allowed to be used by God. And we want to say thank you to all of you, no matter what you do or have done. We thank you so much tonight, because without you, we would not be able to have what we have tonight. And then just to think about the goodness of the Lord when you pulled up today and you looked at what's going on out front. God has been good to us. In 7 years, God has been good. Amen. And we also want to say happy Father's Day to each and every one of our fathers and grandfathers. We looked at a poll this week, and it was a poll that listed the top 10 favorite holidays of the year. We're thankful that Father's Day made it in the top 10, just a little below Groundhog Day, but we did make the top 10, and we're thankful for that. Would all the fathers and grandfathers, would you stand tonight? We want to see all of these great men of God. Before you clap, let me say this. In this day and time, to have a man that's a good or a great father or grandfather is very rare. And these are great men that stand before us today. Let's show all these great men. We appreciate them. Amen. Happy Father's Day to all of us. Amen. 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 And happy Father's Day to Brother Akers as well. He's away from home on today, but we're thankful that you're here, and happy Father's Day to you. Amen. This week coming up is our General Ministers Conference in Cincinnati. We're excited about going and being a part of that. For those of you that can make that, it's going to be some dynamic, inspirational, instructional, informational, wonderful time together. Then next week is Strong Tower Youth Camps, one of the premier youth camps in the country, and so we're going to try to get our young folks there to be a part of that. I was told, too, on August the 25th, there's going to be a golf tournament to raise money for the church, so those of you that want to be a part of that. Then camp meeting coming up in July the 18th through the 20th, and Brother Osborne and Brother Chesser will be ministering to us, so Tri-State District Camp is going to be tremendous this year. We're excited about that. Brother Ragsdale has something he wants to do on behalf of the fathers today. So we're going to ask him to come right now. Would you welcome Brother Ragsdale as he comes?
Happy Father's Day to all of the fathers and grandfathers. It's a special day, and it's great to see everybody in the house of the Lord. We certainly appreciate all of our fathers, but today I want to honor our pastorship on this special day of Father's Day. So I'd like to ask Brother Loveless to come first. Brother Loveless, we have a card from the Promise Church family. Happy Father's Day.
Thank you.
We love you and we appreciate you. And now I'd like our associate pastor, Brother Mike Vickers, to come. Now I'd like for Brother Christian to come. Happy Father's Day, Brother Christian, to the church. And last, as our special speaker, Brother Akers and I go way back. We've been friends a long, long time, and we're so happy for him to be here. And you're going to hear some preaching from the Word of God today, I'll tell you that. So, Pastor Akers, I'd like for you to come. We have a Father's Day card. To stand. Now we're going to pass out the gifts. I want all the dads to stand all over. Brother Ratliff's going to help me. And once you get your gift, you can sit down. So we'll do this real quickly.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Larry. Amen. Don't we appreciate our fathers today? Amen. Happy Father's Day. Amen. And don't we appreciate our Heavenly Father today? Thank God for our Heavenly Father, our Father which art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. Amen. We bless his name today. We honor you today, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. We can't do it long enough. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. We praise you today. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. The Lord bless you. You may be seated. Praise the Lord, everybody. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. It feels so good to be in God's house today. Amen. And I appreciate the presence of the Lord that we feel here as we always do when we come together. And it's so wonderful to see all of you dads and granddads and so on and so forth. We appreciate you. And one statistic that Brother Mike didn't talk about, I thought he was going to. He talked about how rare it is to have a godly man and father and grandfather, but statistically it's moms that normally see that their families in church, and we are so blessed to have all these men, not just providers, but men that bring their family to the house of God and lead as the head of their home and leading in praise and worship and living for the Lord. I'm thankful for that. And Brother Phil, Your scripture that you used today, my Father's God. Amen. I'm glad I had a dad that knew who Jesus was. Amen. Amen. And my sons as well. I'm proud that my own sons can follow in my footsteps, that we're serving the one true God, and his name is Jesus. He is our Father. Amen. I'm thankful for that. Thank you for that scripture today, Brother Christian. Amen. We're honored to have all of you here today. And I want to say happy anniversary. If you've been here from the very get-go, for the whole 7 years, would you stand from the very beginning of this church? Would you look at all these wonderful folks that's been here the entire 7 years? Not only is that exciting, but look how we've grown. Everybody that's sitting down, you've come along since then. We're thankful. We honor all of you today. Amen. Amen. Happy anniversary. Amen. And we're excited for some of you. This may have been the first time you've seen what's going on out front here to the extent that we see it here today, and we're thankful. Hopefully here in the next few months, I'm done putting dates out there. Those guys have made a liar out of me enough. When it's done, it's done. How's that? It'll happen in God's time, and He has a time, and He has a date. I believe it was the apostles asked the Lord, "Wilt thou at this time?" He said, "It's not for you to know the times of the season, so when it's there, it's there." But we're going to give God the praise, honor, and glory until we get there, and we're so thankful. Just because of you, all this is happening out here, and you've given and you've helped and you've sacrificed, and through the help of the Lord, and He gets all the praise, honor, and glory, and we're so thankful for it. We're going to ask our ushers if they'd be coming, and we're going to receive your tithes and offering unto the Lord today. And so in preparation of giving, we'll ask that you would stand. Amen. Now, our middle section, our ushers will assist you in bringing your tithes and offering. Brother Akers, do you recognize these pews? Those are fresh out of FAC Knoxville. But because of our seating situation now, everyone can't march. So if you're on the outside, our ushers will pass the pans to you. And then our middle section, you will march under the direction of our ushers. Brother Dustin, would you ask God to bless our tithes and our offering today? Amen and amen. Our ushers will assist you in giving today.
Mighty God is Jesus, the Prince of Peace is He, the everlasting Father, the King eternally, the wonderful in wisdom, by whom all things are made, the fullness of the Godhead in Jesus is displayed, and it's all in Him. While we play and sing a while, let's fellowship, shake a few hands nearby, love one another for a little time on anniversary service here. Yes, it's all in Him. The mighty God is Jesus, and it's all in Him. Emmanuel, God with us, Jehovah, Lord of hosts, the omnipresent Spirit who fills the universe, the Advocate, the High Priest, the Lamb for sinners slain, the author of redemption, oh glory to His name. And it's all in Him, it's all in Him. The fullness of the Godhead is all in Him. Yes, it's all in Him, it's all in Him. The mighty God is Jesus, and it's all in Him. the Alpha and Omega, beginning and the end, the living Word incarnate, the helpless sinner's friend, the wisdom and perfection, our righteousness and power. Yeah, all we need in Jesus, we'll find this very hour, and it's all in Him. It's all in Him. The fullness of the Godhead is all in Him. Yes, it's all in Him. It's all in Him. The mighty God is Jesus, and it's all in Him. Our God for whom we waited will be the glad refrain of Israel recreated when Jesus comes again. Lo, He will come and save us, our King and Priest to be, for in Him dwells our fullness. Oh, Lord of all is He, and it's all in Him. It's all in Him. The fullness of the Godhead is all in Him. Yes, it's all in Him. It's all in Him. And it's all in Him.
This week was Vacation Bible School around here, and our teen class, high school class, young adult class, I don't know what all age range was in there, but they, on Friday night, they did what's called a cardboard testimony service, and it was so touching, and one of them mentioned that maybe if we could use them one Sunday, that they would like to do that on Sunday, and I thought it would be a great idea on this Father's Day while they were still fresh in doing it, that they would share that with us today. And so they're going to come, some of these young folks, they're the only one that comes here, you know, from high school graduates and college students all the way down to some small kids in our church. There's nobody making them come. They either get on that bus on Wednesday night, or they drive themselves, or they find a ride, however they can get here. And that's just awesome. And so some of the testimonies you will see, as a matter of fact, several of these testimonies are there. It's just their testimony. You know, they don't have a mom and dad that had any much to do with them being in this church, and consequently repenting of their sins, being baptized in Jesus' name, and being filled with the Holy Ghost. Amen. And so you're going to be blessed with these cardboard testimonies at this time as they come.
When you see broken beyond repair, I see healing beyond belief. When you see too far gone, I see one step away from home. Supposed to be this way. Look in the mirror, but you find someone you never thought you'd be. Oh, but I can still recognize the one I love in your tear-stained eyes. I know you might not see it now, so lift your eyes to me. When you see broken beyond repair, I see healing. I paid, and there's nothing you could ever do to lose what grace has won. So hold on, it's not the end. No, this is where love's work begins. I'm making all things new, and I will make a miracle of you. When you see broken beyond repair, I see healing. Far
child, my beloved, the new creation. You're becoming. You see the scars from when you fail, but I see the stories they will tell. You see worthless, but I see priceless. You see pain, but I see a purpose. You see unworthy, undeserving, but I see you through eyes of mercy. When you see broken beyond repair, I see healing beyond belief. You're not too far gone. You're one step away from home. When you see nothing but damaged goods, I see something good in the making. I'm not finished yet, no. When you see wounded, I see mending. Oh, I see mending. Oh, oh, I see mending. I'm not finished yet. When you see wounded, I see mending.
Beautiful. Isn't that beautiful? Look what the Lord can do. Aren't you glad you've got a testimony? Anybody remember where they were when God showed up and how it changed everything? God can turn it all around. And if you're here today and you need turned around, He can do that too. There's a room full of witnesses that will tell you God can change it all in a moment. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. You could be seated if you'd like. So glad to be here today. So glad to experience all this. And I'm thankful it's Father's Day. I'll take this opportunity while we're kind of getting settled. And the Johnsons, if you'll be coming. Sister Bethany, I think, is maybe in the back helping them. Sister Haley, Brother Christian. Sister Bethany, if y'all be making your way. But happy Father's Day. I may have shared this before, I think maybe in a different setting. But Strong Tower Youth Camp was mentioned some time ago. If you can go to that, make sure you do. Raymond Woodward from Canada is very sought after. He'll be there. I was at a meeting a while back, and he brought some statistics that stated that if a child is the first one to come into the church, about 3.5% of the time their family would follow. And mothers, if they're the first person into the church, they beat that number all to pieces. It was 17% of the time the family would follow when mama comes to church first. But if dad comes to church, and if dad's in there, 93% of the time, the family will follow. Come on, fathers, let's be men of God, right? And if things aren't going right, you hang on there. God will use the word of a father and the prayer of a father. Amen? Hallelujah. Come on. Love the Johnsons. They're going to come sing about God and our Father today. Let's just worship with them. Put your hands together again for them as they...
Thank you. Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I am loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect.
Amen. Aren't you thankful for a good Father? Amen. Is He a good Father? Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. If you'd just remain standing, if you're not, if you would join us. I have been for some time now excited about this service today. Because obviously we're celebrating 7 years of all that the Lord has done here at the Promised Church. But in conjunction with that, I was excited, Brother Dustin, about who was coming to preach to us today. Brother David Akers is certainly no stranger to those of us that have grown up in the Tri-State District or even just across the Assemblies of the Lord Jesus Christ. If you have any fellowship with that organization, you have heard this great man of God in some way, and he's touched your life in some way. And, you know, one of the great things about being the pastor, you can just call up your favorites. Amen. And if they're available, it works, don't it? Brother Akers is one of, I'm not just saying this because he's here today. I've told many of you when we were talking about this, he's one of my favorite preachers. His ministry, you know, we've all, maybe we shouldn't be this way, but I am. There's just certain messages and ministers that you can connect with. And he has been one of those in my life. And I'll never forget a message he preached at men's conference a few years ago. I know a man. I'll never in my lifetime forget that message and how it has blessed me. I heard a preacher one time describe himself as a slob doing his job. And his approach, didn't describe him that way, himself. His approach is kind of like that. He can be kind of crude and kind of rude, but very effective in his delivery, and has touched a lot of lives, including mine. But if he was the slob doing his job of Pentecost, this is the gentleman of Pentecost. I had the privilege of bringing him to the pulpit one time at camp meeting, and I said those very same words. And I called you Puddin' earlier because he's smooth. This guy is smooth. And I promise you, you fixing to be blessed with the Word of God. Would you welcome one of my favorite preachers, Brother David Akers and the Lord, as he comes to minister. Would you give the Lord praise right now? Oh, magnify the Lord together. Oh, there's no one like you, Jesus. How many loves the Lord today? How many's thankful to be a part of the family of God? He is a good Father. He's a good God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. The Lord bless you. You may be seated. We say that He is a good God. He's a good Father. And in our language sometimes, people may feel like we're almost dissing the Lord. You know, I've heard people say He's a good God. Somebody will answer, He's a great God. You know, well, I'm not talking about lunch. Yeah. I'm talking about a good God that is great. Amen. We think of good and great as the same thing, more an extreme. But that's not the case. When Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water, that showed that He's a great God. But Peter forgot He was a good God and began to sink. God can do great things in your life, but if you forget He's a good God, you'll go under. No matter how great He is, you need to remember He's a good God. He's a faithful God. He's a loving God. He'll never leave you. He'll never forsake you. How many's found Him to be faithful? Oh, God, You're a good God, a good Father. Amen. Thank you so very much, Brother Lovelace. I heard the other day a story of a little boy that went to school. He wasn't from a very rich home or didn't have much money many years ago. And the teacher was trying to teach math and was wanting to see if little Johnny knew how to add. And the teacher said, little Johnny, if you had $50 in one of your pockets and $50 in another pocket of yours, what would that be? And little Johnny said, that would be that I've got somebody else's pants on. Amen. So his conclusion was, I'm not wearing the right pants if I have $100. And so sometimes you hear these great introductions, and I feel like I'm wearing the wrong shoes or something up here, but I do love Brother Lovelace and his family, and I can tell you that he talks about me being the gentleman, but if I've ever seen anybody that has a gentle spirit and a loving spirit, it is Brother Lovelace, and I'm thankful to be a part of his ministry and his beautiful family today. I give honor to your pastor. I give honor to Brother Vickers and all of these great ministers. I've known so many years, so many of you that are here. And as we were coming in this afternoon, I knew that I was coming into an area that just a few miles down the road is the graves of my grandparents. And my heritage, where I come from, and all of those things takes me back. I occasionally will run across somebody that says they're from the Kingsport area. And I just feel like they got to know somebody I know, or they got to know somebody in my family. But it is a great honor to be here in Church Hill. And we're excited about what God is doing. I look and I see, and I'm a little envious because we have the same growing pains you're having. And that is, we just flat out need to be in another place. We need to be in a bigger place. And that's a good problem. Amen. There's a store in Raleigh down the road from where we live. It's called the Container Store. And I guess you walk in. I've never been in, but I think it is just filled with everything that can contain. You can put a box in it. You can put anything in a box, whatever kind of container you need. And I've wanted to run in that store a few times and scream to the top of my lungs, I just can't contain myself. And find if somebody can find something for me. But the fact is sometimes you get in a place like this and you just can't contain yourself, because you look out and you see what God has been doing these past 7 years. And I think He's worthy of praise one more time, to look around and see the goodness of God. And I'm telling you, who knows what's coming? Hallelujah. Who knows what's coming these next few years in front of you? Amen. Amen. I know the number seven is important in the Word of God. It means completion. It means perfection. And I do believe that there's something powerful in the Word of God when it describes numbers such as seven. And seven times around the city of Jericho. Seven times on the seventh day. And then you have seven times going to look for the cloud. And we find that on that seventh time, there was a sound of abundance of rain. We know that Jesus Christ, when He talked to that woman at the well, He said, you've got five husbands, and the one you're living with's not your own. But you've met the seventh man at the well. His name is Jesus. There's seven churches in the book of Revelation, and we know there's many sevens in that book. But I believe there's something special about this day in Church Hill, Tennessee, where you're celebrating 7 years. I think the walls are about to come down. I think the rain is about to be poured out. I believe God is going to do something faithful and good for the promise. Amen. Amen. Would you stand with me this afternoon? I give honor again to your ministry, your pastor, and these great men of God, and to the saints. I want to honor my wife and my daughter who is with me today. And we ran quickly into the hotel, and I didn't even get a mirror today. I had to stand out and get the mirror in the room and make sure that my pretty 13-year-old was going to look okay today. And I'm so proud of her. I'm a proud father on Father's Day. He's a good father. I'm a proud father. And my oldest son today preached the Word of God in Butner, where I pastor. He's starting a church just down the road, half an hour or so in Wake Forest. And to see God's blessings on our lives is humbling. It really is humbling. And Brother Vickers, we shared a trip to Israel years ago, and a lot of good things. Maybe a few others around here. Been a while back. I have to look the pictures just to remember some of it. If you have your Bibles, please open them this afternoon to the book of 1 Kings, chapter number 21. I just want to minister today to this church and to this body. I'm someone that believes that there's a whole lot more to preaching than just great thoughts, and I believe in ministering. And if I can leave here today knowing that I've said something that can strengthen someone, that can make someone understand that there's not an accident in this building, there's not a part of what is going on in this community with the promise that is not without the hand of God behind it. And I'm going to show you today that God has a purpose and a plan, if I can. 1 Kings chapter number 21. I want to read in verse number 17. And the word of the Lord came to Elijah the Tishbite, saying, arise and go down to meet Ahab, king of Israel, which is in Samaria. Behold, he is in the vineyard of Naboth, whither he is gone down to possess it. And thou shalt speak unto him, saying, thus saith the Lord, hast thou killed and also taken possession? And thou shalt speak unto him, saying, thus saith the Lord, in the place where the dogs lick the blood of Naboth, shall the dogs lick thy blood, even thine. And Ahab said to Elijah, hast thou found me, O mine enemy? And he answered, I have found thee, because thou hast sold thyself to work evil in the sight of the Lord.
So he is now a marked man. He is found. God knows how to find us. Now I'm going to turn this. I know for the seventh anniversary, that's not a positive reading right there. But I believe we've got something for us today. The 22nd chapter and verse number 34. Referring to the same individual, Ahab. And a certain man drew a bow at venture. Somebody say at venture. He drew a certain bow at a venture and smote the king of Israel between the joints of the harness. Wherefore he said unto the driver of the chariot, turn thine hand and carry me out of the host, for I am wounded. And the battle increased that day, and the king was stayed upon the chariot against the Syrians and died at even. And the blood ran out of the wound into the midst of the chariot. And there went a proclamation throughout the host about the going down of the sun, saying, every man to his city, and every man to his own country. So the king died and was brought to Samaria, and they buried the king in Samaria. And one washed the chariot in the pool of Samaria, and the dogs licked up his blood, and they washed his armor according unto the word of the Lord which he spake. Verse 34, and a certain man of the Syrian army, a certain soldier, drew a bow at a venture and smote the king of Israel, that is Ahab. My message this afternoon will be this: the integrity of God's arrows. The integrity of God's arrows. If I could name it a different name, I would simply say there are no random arrows. There are no random arrows. Would you for a moment pray that God would speak to us? Father, I know you have a word. I know you have something that is right on time. If you, God, would but use me, I am a vessel, Lord, of clay. Lord, I am falling short of your glory. But God, today, if you would anoint me, if you would speak to me, God, if you would, Lord, but use me just for a few moments here, open our ears to hear the word of God, and I pray it to be done in the name of Jesus Christ. Let the church shout amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Brother, if you'd help me get those arrows there, thank you. A few months ago, was going down the road. Thank you. If you could set just a couple out in the front, I appreciate that. Just kind of somewhere where they can see it. If I can't preach good, I'll have a couple visual aids to help me here. Brother Carpenter says, just read a bunch of scripture if you can't preach good. Read a lot of Bible. I was traveling, and I heard this in my spirit, and I had to go find it in the scripture. But I heard in my spirit something say, there are no random arrows. It hit me so fierce into my spirit that I immediately, when I got home, I started searching. I felt like I knew where I needed to go. But as I was reading and studying the Word of God, I found that in the scripture that I have read to you in verse 34, that many other translations do not use the word venture. But a lot of the translations, maybe you have one in front of you, they will use the word random in this verse or randomly. It is saying that a soldier randomly shot an arrow into the battle, saying that it was just happened. It was haphazardly that it took place. The word random in the dictionary simply means lacking a definite plan, purpose, or pattern. In other words, it was without any direction that arrow was sent. When I began to study what the word venture means in the Hebrew, I found that it was anything but random. It did not mean at all the word random. It is a word that I will describe to you in just a few moments, but I can tell you that there is no such thing as a random arrow in the will of God. God had spoken through the prophet. He had said in his word, "Thus saith the Lord, I've seen what you have done to Naboth, that you have had him killed, you have taken his vineyard." And he said, "You will die." Elijah gives to Ahab the death that he is going to die. At that moment, according to the word of God, Ahab is a marked man. Ahab has a target on his back. I've said it, I kind of laugh sometimes with the home church, but I hear people say, "I think God's trying to kill me. And I think God's trying to get me." I've let them know that if God's trying to kill you, you'd be killed. You'd be kilt, as would say. You'd be dead. If God was trying to get you, you'd have been gotten already, right? And so you have to understand that it is not that God is after. Now, we can feel that way sometimes, but I've come to this pulpit today to tell somebody that there is no accidents in the kingdom of God. There is no such thing as random living in the kingdom of God. I've come to believe what the Word of God says, that all things work together for good. According to those that love God, according to those that are called of His purpose. How many's glad there's a reason to be here today? You didn't just randomly walk into this building today. You didn't just haphazardly walk into this building today. There's a reason why you're here today. And God's had it ordained for many, many years. There is a plan. Ahab gets himself on a battlefield. He is running from God, but you can't run from God. He pulls a good man into his story. He pulls that. Let me just warn you here. Sometimes folks that are running from God, they like to pull other folks into their drama. They like to pull other folks into their soap opera living for God. And so Ahab does this. He pulls in Jehoshaphat. Jehoshaphat kind of is suckered into this meeting where he is about to go to war and partnering up with Ahab. And Jehoshaphat gets to looking around and notices that all he's seeing is a bunch of false prophets that are telling them they can win the battle. These are the words that are found by Jehoshaphat in verse 7. "Is there not here a prophet of the Lord besides all these 400 other prophets, that we may or might inquire of him?" And Ahab, the king of Israel, said unto Jehoshaphat, "There is yet one man, Micaiah, the son of Imla, by whom we may inquire of the Lord. But I hate him." I love that verse, tickles me, because at least he's being real. Yeah, I'd rather somebody just tell me they don't like me than to just put the little show on and then we hear about it later on Facebook. But the fact is, let's just say it. He said, "But I hate him, for he does not prophesy good concerning me, but evil." And Jehoshaphat said, let not the king say so. He said, "Don't say that." He said, "Don't talk like that." But you see, Ahab said, "I know where I can find truth." Now, there may be 400 false prophets that have put a little show on this day. If you'll read that chapter, please don't do it right now. But if you'll read that chapter later, you'll find they've called in the false prophets. Hundreds of them are backing one another up and saying everything is going to be all right. You guys just go out on the battlefield and fight away. God's on your side. But Jehoshaphat knew enough about truth and he knew enough about the word of God that he said, "Hang on. Before I take one step into the battlefield, I need to know we've heard from God. May I tell you, I will take one man of God over 400 false prophets any day. I don't care what the world is saying, and I don't care what the soothsayers are saying. God, give us men in a pulpit that know how to preach the word. Give us men that'll tell us the truth. Anybody thankful for a holiness preacher? Anybody thankful for a man of God that believes the word is the word? I'm going to tell you, we better be very careful in this hour that we live, that we don't get caught up in the world's understanding of this last day. There are many that are in pulpits that are saying, peace, peace, but sudden destruction shall come. The Bible warns us of a seducing spirit, a day of seducing spirits. Matter of fact, I find them in this very chapter. The scripture talks about in heaven, there were spirits before God that said, let me go, and I will be a lying spirit. In this chapter, it's one of the most bizarre readings in the Bible. It said, let me go and I will lie to Ahab. I will tell him everything's going to be all right. And do you know God allowed that spirit to go? I believe that God allows things to come in our lives. And he's told us to try the spirits, to know the spirits. That's why we need discernment in this hour, where we are just not listening to any old thing that comes along with a Bible in his hand. But we need someone that'll say, God, give me a discerning ear, that when I hear it, I know that man's preaching the truth. I know that man's telling me the word of God. I'd rather it be unpopular, but it's the truth, than to everybody pat me on the back and say, great job, preacher. Matter of fact, let me read it out of the Living Bible. It says, don't you see, this is verse 23. Don't you see the Lord? This is what the prophet, the true prophet said. Micaiah said, the Lord has put a lying spirit in the mouths of all these prophets. But the fact of the matter is that the Lord has decreed disaster upon you. Now let me back up. I love this because there's nothing like a sarcastic preacher. I heard somebody a few months ago say they didn't like sarcasm. They thought it was of the devil. That's just because you're not smart enough to get it sometimes. But the fact is we're not online, are we? Got to be careful. The fact is that this is a prophet that has watched all of these false prophets, and they put on their little show and they've said, go, go, you're going to be okay. The false prophets were lying. Well, when Micaiah was put before them and the scripture says, tell us, prophet, what will become in this battle? I love what the prophet did. He just simply said, hey, you guys go ahead. It's going to be all right. Everything, you're good. Well, when he did that, Ahab got so mad. He said, Micaiah, how many times am I going to have to tell you to tell me the truth? He knew that this great man of God was saying, listen, you want to believe a lie? Go ahead and believe a lie. But he stopped, which lets us know, I don't care how many lying spirits got into the field that day, Ahab knew what the truth was. He had already heard the truth from Elijah. May I tell you, don't you let somebody talk you out of what you know's in the Word of God. Don't you let somebody try to talk you out of what you know is truth. You know what the Word of God says. You know what it takes to go to heaven. You know the Word. You must be born again of water and spirit. There's only one God, and his name is Jesus. You know what the truth is. Somebody shout hallelujah. And so he said, tell me the truth. And when he said it, he lit into him. He said, don't you see, Ahab? The Lord's put a lying spirit in the mouth of all these prophets. But the fact of the matter is, the Lord has decreed disaster upon you. Then Zedekiah, one of the false prophets, walked over and slapped Micaiah on the face. When did the Spirit of the Lord leave me and speak to you? He said. Oh, he put a big show on. Left the man of God with a mark on his face. And you know what Micaiah turned and answered him? He said, I'm going to tell you, you will have the answer to your question when you find yourself hiding in an inner room. That's all it said. That'd give me shivers right there. If a prophet looked at me and said, you're going to find out one day in a place, in an inner room when nobody's around. I'd be checking my ticker. I'd be thinking, God, what do I need to get? Anybody know about the inner chamber? When you walked out of the house of God, you hadn't listened. Now listen, you're serving God, you ought to say hallelujah. But we've not always been so obedient at times. How many remembers a few times when God spoke to you and it wasn't around an altar or in a church house? but it was in the inner chamber. Anybody remember a few times? And so it was here that we understand that God is saying you can run, but you cannot hide. That reminds me of what Elijah had told Ahab in the reading of chapter 21. When Elijah found him, Ahab said, "Hast thou found me, O mine enemy?" And Elijah's answer was in verse 20, he said, "I have found thee because thou hast sold thyself to the work to work evil." I'm just coming today. Now I'm getting to the good part, but I've just come to tell you that God knows how to find every one of us. I'm telling you, you can run, but you cannot hide. He knows where you are, and I'm glad He knows where I am because He's pursued me. How many's ever run from the Lord, but you find out you can't outrun this good God? How many's ever found yourself running from a call, but you know God's going to catch up with you? I'm just telling somebody, God knows where you are today. You're not in here by accident. You're not in here by chance. Well, I'm just here with a friend. I'm here because of Daddy. I'm here because of Father's Day. I got news for you. This was a setup from the beginning. God knew you were coming today, and God knew I was coming. And God said, "Preach to them that they're not an accident, and God has a plan for your life today." Hallelujah. So, just a few weeks ago, I saw this in the newspaper. The headlines, literally, this is not made up. The headlines read, just a few weeks ago, "Man bitten by shark, previously mauled by bear, and bitten by snake." That was the headlines. I'm telling you, when I read that, I thought I'd stay out of the water and out of the woods. I'd just go ahead and have an inside life. I think I'd just go to the mall every week. Because everywhere this guy went, something was after him. But it reminded me of a verse in the Old Testament about the day of the Lord. Somebody talking about the day of the Lord that is coming. That somehow they're going to manage to get through the day of the Lord. Nobody can outrun the day of the Lord. Amos said, here's what the day of the Lord is going to be like. "As if a man did flee from a lion, and a bear met him, or went into the house and leaned his hand on the wall and a serpent bit him." He said, you can't outrun God. You run from a bear, you're going to meet a lion. You run into the house and say, "Whoa, I'm safe." And he said, there's a serpent waiting to bite you. I've come to tell somebody today that you need to just stop your running and let God find you today, and let God become your Savior today, because He is the Lord. And He has proclaimed. Somebody hear me today. Now, so Ahab said, "All right, let's go to war. Let's go to battle." He said, "But I'm going to tell you, I know Elijah told me God's going to get me, and I know Micaiah told me. I know he told me I'm in trouble. What I'll do is I'll just disguise myself." And oh, I could preach there for a while about how folks are wearing masks, how folks think they're hiding from God, like the little boy thinks that he's hid from his father and he's over behind the curtain and his feet are showing. And just those, you know, those little times. Anybody remember hide and seek when your children were little and you let them think they were good and hidden? Now, there's something about it. Here's the way you do it. As a parent, you can hide and you'll scare your kids to death. They'd look for an hour and a half and they'd never find you. If God wants to hide, you're never going to find Him until He lets you find Him. And thank God He lets you find Him. But you can't hide from God. It's not the opposite. God knows where you are. And so He gets out into the battlefield. He's got this disguise. Matter of fact, they thought Jehoshaphat was him for a moment. And then they realized that's not Ahab. And the king of Syria said, "We're going after Ahab. Leave everybody else alone." God has got you marked, my friend. And then this is where we get to the scripture. I got to hurry. The Bible says that there was a soldier in Syria Syria. They didn't know who Ahab was. Ahab had disguised himself. Normally these men go out in their robes. They go out very proud of their kingship, their royalty, but not so. He had hidden himself, and so the armies of Syria didn't know who he was. But God knew where he was. God knew exactly what chariot he was in. And the Bible says a soldier pulled back the bow, the string of the bow, and he released it at a venture. And it found the heart. It found a chink in the armor of Ahab, and it mortally wounded him. God found Ahab. But I go now to the word venture. I've come to tell you it wasn't an accident. The word venture is not at all random, as I said earlier. The Hebrew word for venture is important to understand today. It means in the Hebrew, according to integrity. According to integrity. In other words, there's a couple of thoughts here of what this might mean. It may mean this, that soldier, the Syrian soldier, he pulled the bow back and he had no qualm. He had no bones to pick. He had no ulterior motives. He just simply was pure in his reaching forth and shooting the bow. He wasn't aiming at anybody to hurt anybody. That's one meaning. Another meaning is that it means perfect or utmost strength. It is saying that with everything he had, the purest of heart, with integrity, he pulled the bow back as far as he could pull it, and he released it with all his strength. The bow soared into the air, but I've got a third meaning that I believe this means. It's not anything to do with a Syrian soldier, but it has everything to do with the word that arrow rode upon. For God had said, you can run, but you cannot hide. And I will repay Ahab what you've done to Naboth. And so when that release of that arrow took place, as it went through the air, God's power and God's winds began to change on that shaft and on that arrow. And God said, you are to go right there. And when it found its mark, it had the power, it had the integrity of a mighty God and the promise behind it. I've come to tell you that the arrows of life are not by accident. And that whatever you may be feeling in your life today, you need to do more than say, well, that's just life, that's fate. It is much more than fatalistic. But there's a God of purpose, and there's a God of planning. And God knows exactly where you are today. And he's come to send a man in a pulpit to preach the word. And this word's going to find you. This word is going to seek you out. The Spirit of God searches all things. If you believe that today, give the Lord praise right now. Hallelujah. He pulled that bow as far back as he could get it. All he had inside of him. And when he released it, he said, it's now in the control of the winds. No, no, sir. It's not controlled by nature anymore. It's not controlled by man. I've come to this pulpit. Why are you preaching this? Because I've come to tell somebody that the promise is not randomly sitting on this property today. That we are not randomly in this place today. But 7 years ago, somebody said, let's shoot this thing. Let's do this thing. And God said, if you'll do it, I'll lead it. If you'll put your strength into it, I'll make sure it gets where I'm telling it to go. God's got a plan. God's got a purpose. God's got integrity behind his words. And what he said he's going to do, he will provide every need. If you believe that, I want you to give God a shout this day. Hallelujah. It's got God's reputation riding on it. It's got the integrity of his word riding on it. And God says, I'm going to make it hit. Wherever he shot, it wasn't up to flesh and blood. This thing wasn't born by flesh and blood, and it's not going to finish by flesh and blood. Let us not be so foolish, having begun in the Spirit, that we think we can finish this thing with our own talent and ability. If this thing was born in the Holy Ghost, let it be maneuvered by the Holy Ghost. If this thing was birthed in revival and the Spirit, then let God get in the winds and let Him take it to the destiny. Psalm 7 and 13. He has also prepared for him for the instruments of death. But notice, second part of this verse. He ordaineth his arrows against the persecutors. I looked up the word ordain. It means to work for and to be committed to. God has ordained the arrows. God has a mark. I think it's an interesting thing. When we think about the word sin, it is a small little word. You know, it's smaller than a four-letter word. It's sin, you know, just little old sin. And somebody say it's just a little old this or a little old that. But the Bible talks about the power behind sin. Do you know what the word sin means? I think many of you probably do. The word sin means to miss the mark. That's what it means in the original, to miss the mark. It means I don't care how close you got, you missed. I don't care how close, you know, somebody said close only means that it's something in horseshoes. You know, it only means, then that's a good point. But the fact is to just miss heaven by a little bit, as Brother James would say, is all of hell. I don't want to miss heaven by just a little bit. I don't want to miss the plan of God by just a little bit. I've come today to tell somebody it's that little bit that God wants you to work on right now and say, God, whether I'm a mile from the mark or an inch from the mark, I'm still in sin. But God, when I do it your way, when I do it your way, that means it must mean to hit the mark. I've come to tell somebody, if you let go of those things that you think you can't live without, God's got a target. God's got a plan. God's got a calling. God's got a power. Anybody want a Holy Ghost revival? Then let's say, God, hit the mark in my life. I want your will to be done. I am amazed. I am amazed at what people let keep them away from ministry. I'm amazed at what will keep people from being on a platform or being in a Sunday school room teaching. But just, well, you know, you pass that little handbook out, you ask us to do a few things. May I just tell you, of course, that's between you and your pastor. But may I tell you, why would you let something so small and insignificant, by the way, sometimes when you get a job, they ask you to do stuff too. I'm just amazed at what folks will do to get a job, to get a $2 raise. But the church says, would you do this just so we can have unity, just so we can be where we need to be? Oh, I don't think I can do that. Would you just say, God, well, let that arrow hit me today. I want to do your will. I want your kingdom to come. I want your will to be done. I want to do a work for God. Not my will, thy will be done. Let go of those little things that don't matter. Let go of those things. Become a minister. Become a ministry. Let the arrow find its target. Let God's word speak to you today. Stop dodging the bullet today. You know God's going to get you one way or the other. Let Him go ahead and get you in a service like this today. Don't let Him have to talk to you out there. Don't let Him have to talk to you through things that are painful. Let Him talk to you through the Word of God today. You know, God talks to us through affliction. God talks to us through pain. I was praying just a couple of days ago at home, and God spoke to me about how He deals. And the reason He spoke to me, because I believe He's wanting me to pray for the pastors across this land. Because I believe that the pastor and the ministry, of the fivefold ministry and the work of God and the preaching from a pulpit is God's front line and first line to reach His people. I believe God wants you to hear me today. I believe he wants you to hear your pastor preach today. And I believe he wants us to mix it with faith and say, God, thank you for talking to me. I've seen folks get a little tripped up because, you know, the pastor's preaching something that he knows I'm doing. Well, what is he supposed to do? If he knows you're doing it, is he not allowed to preach about it? If he knows you're doing it, is he supposed to skip that part of the sermon? Matter of fact, you know what? I'm going to shock you. But sometimes God comes down into my mind and he blocks that part. And I'm preaching away and I'm thumping the pulpit and I'm just looking like I'm the boldest fella in town. And then in the back of my mind go, ooh, that's right. So-and-so back there's been doing this. Are you hearing me today? I'm smiling. I don't know if you are. I'm just telling you, God knows how to let his preacher go. And then all of a sudden, I'm kind of backpedaling. Now, folks, I just had a conversation the other day with somebody about this, and I hope you don't think I'm coming at you. Well, what if the man is? Wouldn't you say, God, thank you for a pastor? Thank you for a pastor that'll call me on the phone and say, hey, you know, that may not be a good idea what you're putting on Facebook right now. Hey, you know, that may not be a good thing where I hear you're going. Hey, you might be getting careful where you're going, who you're going with. Oh, this is a good time to back me right now. Don't tell on yourself. I'm just telling somebody you need a pastor. And thank God, God uses the voice of the man of God. Well, here's what you need to understand. That's the first line. That's what God wants you to do. But if you don't, there's a second way God gets you. And if you're in, when I say get you, I mean get you like Daddy used to get you. How many remembers how Daddy used to get you? I remember how Daddy used to get me. In other words, if I don't listen to his voice, there are other persuasions to follow. Lamentations 3:12. This is way down the list, by the way. I gave him some verses. He hath bent his bow and set me as a mark for the arrows. He has caused the arrows of his quiver to enter into my reins. Lamentations is saying, God, you have found me and you have afflicted me. And Lord, you have worked on me. How many's glad that the arrow of affliction will find you sometimes? Job 6:4, for the arrows of the Almighty are within me. The poison whereof drinketh up my spirit. He's saying, God, you found me. I'm not sure, God, what's going on, but your arrows have found me. But the psalmist would say this, before I was afflicted, I went astray. But now have I kept thy word. He said, Lord, before the pain hit my life, I had a bad habit of straying. I had a bad habit of wandering. But God, you sent a word. You sent some pain. You sent a little bit of affliction. And God, it got me back to the pew. It got me back to an altar. It got me back to fellowship. Well, come on now. I'm going to preach down here. It's a lot cooler down here than it is up there, I promise you. I'm so glad. Somebody said, well, God, I don't know that God's ever done that to me. I would be very concerned when your father is not spanking you. Because the Bible says you may not be his son, and I won't tell you how it puts it in Hebrews. It says that a good father will say, son, I don't want to do this. And matter of fact, it says when God does it, it's truly for your good. He said it is for you to know. Oh, I thank God that there's no random arrows. As I want to just move into some things. As I said, I want to minister for just a few minutes today. I want to show you some things today that I believe God wants for you as the promised church to understand. The arrows of God's destiny are for your life. 1 Samuel 20:36. The Bible is here telling us a story concerning David and Jonathan. If you will recall, Jonathan has had a conversation with David earlier in the week. And he has said, now David, I'm going to meet you at a certain day. And he said, David, if you hear these words, the arrows are on this side of you. He said, I will be talking to my servant. I'm going to go out and do a little target practice. And he said, if I tell the servant the arrows are toward me, he said, that means you can go home with me that day. Everything's safe. It is a signal to you that my father is fine. He's not angry. But he said, David, if you hear me say these words to my servant, the arrows are beyond thee. He said, that's a signal to you. He said, don't you make a move. Don't you let my servant see you. He said, because my father wants to kill you. The day came, and the Bible says the servant went out with Jonathan, not knowing Jonathan was to meet David. And so they got out there, and sure enough, Jonathan he shot the arrows, and all it was to the servant was just target practice. He goes out to look, and Jonathan cries out these words, and here it is in Samuel 20. And he said unto the lad, run, find out now the arrows which I shoot. And as the lad ran, and he shot an arrow beyond him. And when the lad was come to the place of the arrow which Jonathan had shot, Jonathan cried after the lad and said, is not the arrow beyond thee? He was telling David, David, you're right. My father wants to kill you. You see, David knew that he was anointed. And David understood the call of God was powerful in his life. But he could not understand where God was taking him. I've come to tell you there's an anointing in your life. But just because you're anointed doesn't mean you have the plan figured out. God will put anointing on you. But before he puts you in the position of that anointing, he will make sure that he digs into your life. And he builds the character that will equal the call. And some of you have felt a call. Some of you have felt an anointing, but I've come to tell you, your life is like David's. The arrow is beyond you. Is not the arrow beyond you? I've come to tell someone today that anything that God does worth doing in your life will always be beyond your ability, beyond your own strength, beyond your own talent, and beyond your own ingenuity. God's come to say the promise today that what I called you to do 7 years ago has always been beyond you. But if you will start trusting me today, if you will continue in your faith, one day what I've called you to be, I'm telling you, can I just guess? I'm not going to prophesy. I'm going to do a little spiritual guessing. My guess is that your pastor and these leaders don't see you staying here. And they don't even see you staying here. They see something a lot bigger. If you believe that right now, you say, God, the arrows are beyond us. But greater is he that's in us. Anybody want to see God do something beyond you? The arrows of destiny, the arrows of integrity, what God has shot forth from this church will bring great revival. If you believe that, clap your hands and give God praise. I think I share a kindred spirit of what you've seen here. When we went to North Carolina 13 years ago, many would have said, that's so random. That's so out of character. But when you know God's called you to do something, you pull the bow and you let go. And then you let God do the rest. Now, you don't sit there. You let God take control. You do what you can. And then God does the rest. There were several years. And I don't know if this will ring a bell here. But I'm just going to share my story. The first few years when we went to Butner, North Carolina, just above Durham, we had some battles. The first 3 years of me being in Butner, I told God one day, I said, God, if you don't slow it down time-wise, I'm going to be an old man. I'm going to look up one day. And it was going that fast. I don't remember the first 3 or 4 years of my daughter's life as far as those years. When we went there, she was 3 months old. It went so fast that I asked God, please. Now, sometimes I've asked him to speed it up, you know. But I had to ask him to slow it down. It wasn't all because we were just so, everything was dynamic. I had my life threatened more than once. We had things that, honestly, if I told you the story, and I won't tell you the story. But if I could, you can believe this or not, but it is the truth, and God knows it's the truth. If what happened in the church that I pastor could have easily been in headline news. The things that went on that dealt with what could have destroyed a church. I had a lawyer that I called. It went on. I use these sort of phrases. People go, my Lord, what in the world happened? I'm telling you, I was waiting. And my attorney told me, get ready to make a media statement to the news. They're going to call you. And it dealt with embezzlement. It dealt with somebody in the church there that was there before I got there. And so I just want to kind of give you that. Nobody got shot or murdered, so and we buried him in the back or anything, so nothing like that. But I watched the church. I watched the church, what looked like could have easily destroyed us. And I watched God take us through some horrible things. But I laid down one night, tears running down my cheek, laying there in bed. And the stuff I went through during one Christmas of with all that, laying there and dealing with pressures that I have never dealt with in my life. And I started looking up into heaven, and I said to God, and I said it jokingly, but I said, God, this trouble was here before I got here. I didn't create this. I'm a man, Lord, that has a clean record financially. I'm a man, Lord, that this stuff could destroy my reputation and it could assassinate my character. God, I don't know why I'm here, but I know I'm called. And I remember that night as I was praying, I said, but God, I tell you what I'm going to do for you. I'm going to stick it out. I was telling him, now, God, I didn't cause this trouble, but Lord, I'll help you out here. I'll stay. Because everything in me wanted to run. Get out of there. Let it be their problem. I hadn't been there long enough that it needed to be my problem. But you know what God did? Amongst all of it, we watched that church go from just a small group to where we are at a place where, again, just like you, where are we going to go? What are we going to do? And that's the next step. And I'm watching these things. But this is what I was going to tell you a moment ago. I battled a great, great spirit against me when I first got there, of illegitimacy. Illegitimacy. There was a tremendous church just 20 miles down the road, and a well-known pastor, a well-known church, integrity. I mean, the church, if I named it, most of you say, I've heard of her, many of you have. And so I didn't even want to go to that community because that church was down the road. I thought, God, why am I going there when there's already a church that is running all these people and this man is known across the world? And Lord, what am I going to do? Send me somewhere where there's nobody like that. Send me. You know, I'd been up in Campbell County, Tennessee here, and I know churches around that area. And now I'm going and I'm feeling like I'm under the shadow of a giant of a preacher. And for a long time, I'd walk those aisles of my church and I'd feel like I was illegitimate. I would feel like our church isn't legitimate like that church. Our church, we've got folks that have come out of troubled backgrounds, and we've got folks here that maybe they're not maybe got the cleanest record. And I just kept feeling like we were illegitimate. And one day I said, God, I got to get rid of this feeling that we're an illegitimate people, that somehow we're the stepchildren of the kingdom of God. I've got to get rid of this feeling that somehow, Lord, we're not the group, Lord. And I have begun to resist that old spirit, because God began to deal with me that there are no random churches, and there are no random works, and there are no random arrows. And I don't know, maybe I hope to God you've never had to face that. But if there ever comes a spirit against you that tells you you're not legitimate, you need to stop and say, this is of the Lord, and what God has built, nobody is able to bring it down. What what I've come to tell somebody today is there is no random ministry. There is no random calls. There is no random sermons. There is no random church. Let us have a move of God and let God do the rest. Anybody want God to do the rest? Go ahead. It's beyond me. Now we sit and we fill a building up now and we're starting a church, and sometimes I think we're crazy to do all the stuff we're doing. There's a $13 million building down the road that I'm not paying $13 million for, but I'd give them two. I'd give them two. I told them I'll give you $2 million for this $13 million building, and they said no. And that's the last thing I heard from him. But I keep going to him, saying, you're a good, good father. And Lord, that building's right out there on that interstate. And if anybody knows Richie Brothers' owner, it's a multi-billion dollar industry. If you know anybody in here knows the Richie Brothers president, it's from Canada. But you just let me know, because he needs to sell that building to us. Because we need that 500-seat auditorium, and we need that location on the highway. And you know why? I woke up the other morning. I hadn't thought about that building in a while, but I woke up the other morning. It was on my mind. And I said, God, you can do this. Lord, we're legitimate. This is legit. We're too legit to quit. Anybody willing to get with me now? I just started wrapping up here, folks. I'm just telling you, you're too legit to quit. And somebody right now needs to say, God, everything you've told us, you're going to do. And that's just a part of the process out there. How many's rejoicing that the arrows are beyond thee? How many's rejoicing that there's no random arrows and God has a plan? If you believe that, give him a shout. Hallelujah. I'm almost finished. Let me close here. Second Kings 13, verse 15. Elisha said unto him, this is Joash. Joash is needing direction from God. He comes to Elisha, and Elisha is on his deathbed. Elisha is days away from dying. Laying there, the Bible says that Joash comes in and he cries out to the prophet, please, I need direction. And he says unto him, take bow and arrows. And he took unto him bow and arrows. And he said to the king of Israel, put thine hand upon the bow. And he put his hand upon it. And Elisha put his hands upon the king's hands. In other words, he got up against him, and the king had the bow. And the prophet just simply opened the window and gave him direction. And he said, open the window eastward. He opened it. And Elisha said, shoot. And he shot. And the prophet said, now listen, the arrow of the Lord's deliverance and the arrow of deliverance from Syria. Okay, that means something. Because when you hear him say that, now that we have that established, you can understand the rest of this chapter. For thou shalt smite the Syrians in Aphek, till thou have consumed them. And he said, the prophet said, take the arrows. And he took them. And he said unto the king of Israel, smite the ground. And he smote thrice and stayed. He stopped. And the man of God was wroth with him and said, thou shouldest have smitten 5 or 6 times. Then hadst thou smitten Syria till thou hadst consumed it, whereas now thou shalt smite Syria thrice. At one time, I kind of was blind to a little bit of something very simple here. And that is, I looked and I thought, why would he be upset? How would the king know? How would the king know that there was something behind what he was asking him? He didn't make it clear. He didn't say, now Joash, as many times as you smite the ground, this will be the amount of times that you win against Syria. If he'd have said that, made it that simple, I think, you know, all of us would have said, all right, as far as I can count. But he did tell him. He had already said, these are the arrows of deliverance. He already told him, these are symbols of what God is going to do to Syria. Now smite the ground. That's all the king should have needed to know, if this is a symbol of God's word and God's promise. You are not going to stop me from making this happen. I am going to make sure that this happens. But instead, it was only a quick 1, 2, 3, and it was over. I don't know. Maybe he felt a little embarrassed. Maybe pride got a hold of him. Maybe felt a little silly holding those arrows in his hand and thinking, this is silly. This is ridiculous. But if he knew that that represented the arrows of deliverance, something should have got a hold of him that said, God, I can't do this without you. I've got to do this with the power of God. Our Lord needs you. I've come to tell you that there's a destiny in this building, that there is an integrity of God's word in this building. And what God has said he's going to do, he will do. If somebody will pick up the arrows today and say, this is my destiny, and somebody will say, he's let us know what he's going to do. Now, is there anybody that will inquire of him and say, God, remember what you told us, what you were going to do? Is there anybody that needs a miracle today? Then you need to get to your feet and say, God, you've told me that I'm going to get a miracle today. Is there anybody that needs an answer today? You need to push past that old pride and say, God, I need something. And I'm not going to get it without putting everything I've got. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Deliverance is in this house. Miracles are in this house. Divine appointment is in this house. If you believe that, stand to your feet and give God praise. Come on, give God praise. Anybody want revival? Anybody want to see this church explode? Anybody want to say, we're too legit to quit? Why don't you come up here and say, yeah, God, I'm ready for revival. I'm ready for anointing. I'm ready for ministry. I'm ready, God. I'm ready, God. Here it comes, God. Anybody? Oh, yeah. Well, I'm waiting on him to get to something. And you're done waiting too late because I can't get any further than where I've been. I don't know. I just think if somebody had needed something, they'd already been up here and said, I know that's just an arrow, but I need a healing from my body. I got three right here. Anybody? You say, I'm not going to do that. Okay, King. You're going to get a pew miracle. But right now, somebody can run up and say, I need something for my family. I need my family to be saved. I need my children to be. Anybody? Anybody have any sons or daughters? God? Does anybody think I just randomly preached that today? Does anybody think that was just the best sermon I have? Somebody today needs a miracle. And I'm going to try one more time to convince you that if you'll make a move right now, God's going to do something. All right, go put it out. You can have it too. Right there, take one. I got one more. Right there, in the name of Jesus. I'm telling you, folks, God doesn't give a preacher a word, and then we say it's just him preaching. Somebody right now, you say, well, it's too late. No, it's not too late. Get up here where the fire is hot. Come up here and let God do something for you. I'm welcoming anybody that will make a move and say, God, I need revival for my family. I need revival for my children. I need revival for my neighborhood. I need God, a calling. I'm not going to run anymore. Come on, God's talking to somebody. Hallelujah, I'm believing this today. I'm not preaching this by accident. This is not a random word. Yeah, la la la,